also that what are the fundamental algorithms are running in background of various image processing tools like a Photoshop or CorelDRAW or any other applications. Well, so you can easily correlate that, okay, when I'm doing something in Photoshop or in CorelDRAW or in any other such graphics processing tool, what mathematically exactly happening in background. Okay, so I'll try to go to that particular part if time permits. So I'll start with the applications to motivate you that and to let you know that where image processing stands and where you can utilize the concepts of image processing. So the automatic number plate recognition it was very widely popular application, but nowadays it has been replaced by that fast tag. So till date, the toll collection was manual. Like we have to manually pay the fees, pay the toll, and that person will do some entries in server and that all. So that was a very tedious task, and it was very much time consuming. And you might have observed that hours of time was spent in queues and all. So if we can do something like automatic number plate recognition, so the setup has been shown here. Like one camera would be installed somewhere here, and that will be continuously monitoring the flow of the vehicle, and it is capturing the number plate. That number plate will be given to the image processing module. That module will extract the number plate, will do some processing like contrast enhancement, some morphological operations, then maybe a line segmentation, character segmentation, and finally it will recognize each character into that number plate. So ultimately, the number plate recognition is nothing but to convert this image of number plate into digital form. Okay. Now, this number plate has been recognized, and now this query will be fired to the RTO database. And RTO database will be connected with the bank also, so that automatically that amount will be deducted from the driver or owner's account. So the task of toll collection could be automatized, and it could be very fast. And that will definitely save a lot of amount of time as well as money also. The another very popular application is a smile detection. You might have noticed it on many cameras as well as on mobile phone also, this feature is available. So everybody loves to be clicked when the face is smiley. Okay. But many times when we are clicking, the face may not be an exact smiley position. So what happens, these tools or the algorithm which is running in background of the camera, it will continuously processing the frames in real time. And whenever it sees that someone has smile on his face, then automatically it will take the shot. Okay, so you can get a better pictures. Face detection is also very important, because to detect the smiley first, the first step is to detect the face. If face is present, then we can detect the smiley, or we can recognize the face. So face detection is also very, very common feature in many cameras as well as in mobile also. Fine. All the DSLR cameras are having a special effects when you click faces, when you click mountains, when you click trees, when you click childs, when you click objects. So all are having a different settings. So if face is recognized, then face is detected, then automatically camera can set to those all settings, so that you will get a better quality image. You don't need to manually change its ISO and all. Face recognition is very, very popular application of image processing. And you might have observed also, like as soon as you are uploading the image in Facebook, fine, see, look at this animation. Some person is uploading his or her image, and as soon as image is uploaded, you can see that automatically some tag has been added here, that is Rebecca. So what is happening, as soon as this image is uploaded on Facebook server, that server will run a face recognition application on this image, and whatever faces are recognized, it will automatically tag by default to those faces. Fine. So if there are five persons are present into this image, then all five persons will be tagged automatically. So they will come to know that, okay, someone has tagged to me. Okay, so they will get the notification, something like that. And face recognition can be done in many different number of ways. There are at least 100 different algorithms are available for the face recognition. And you can opt this as your project also for the final year, or maybe for pre-final year project also, you can opt. Not only this one, but many of the applications which I'm discussing can be opted as the project also. So consider this session as a potential opportunity for exploring the image processing in practice. Okay, just not, don't take it just an informative session. You can actually take it to the higher level also. Another application is iris recognition. Like the faces, every human has a unique or a different iris pattern. Okay, the blood vessels or the pattern inside this iris is different for each and every person. But the thing is that we need a special type of cameras or scanner to capture the iris. Okay, like when we go to the Aadhaar card for some other such biometric system, they are scanning our eyes. Fine. So this is more secure compared to face, because anyone can manipulate with the system by showing your photograph or showing your video to the camera. But it is hard to fool the system by showing the iris. Fine, because iris is very small. So even if someone shows your photo to the camera, that camera may not be able to recognize the person from the iris. Because in camera, that iris will look very small. Okay, so you need a special kind of scanners and cameras for that. And you have to put your iris very close to the camera. Then only it will be correctly recognize the person. And I don't know whether you know about this story or not, but this is very popular story of one Afghan girl. She was lost in 1984. And then she was found in 2002 in some region. And based on the iris pattern of that girl was identified that she was lost in 1984 in Afghan. And this is really very interesting story. You can read it on anywhere on a website. Yeah, so you just go through this, that this pattern will remain unique. See, that is what beauty of this iris recognition is. Even after, maybe around 20 years, the iris pattern was unique. Okay? We are growing up, our facial muscles are changing, but this iris pattern will remain almost identical. Authentication also, it's a very popular application, like we are using fingerprint recognition on mobile, or we are using a thumb or face for unlocking the laptop. Friends, all are running image processing modules in background. So as soon as you put your finger or you show your face to the camera, so that background application will start processing that image, and it will try to match with the templates stored into that system. And if match is found, it will unlock. Otherwise, it will ask you to try again. Morphing is also very important application from the viewpoint of industry, film industry specifically, as well as in animation. Fine, like one object will smoothly transfer into another object. So that is what called a morphing. So you might have seen it in many Hollywood movies, like some machine is being transferred into some another object, or maybe in human and so on. Fine, so that's what called a morphing is. Like sometimes some person is transferring into some animals, or animal may be transferring into some another shape. So all these are called a morphing. So the accuracy, or you can say the acceptability of morphing, depends on what type of algorithms you are choosing. Fine, somehow you have to match the source into the destination, but the way you are matching it, that will be different every time. You see that whatever image is shown on right hand side, this GIF image, it's very poor morphing. That girl is being transferred into boy, but that morphing is very, very poor. Whereas look at this still image. It's nicely transferred from George Bush to Barack Obama. Okay, so that depends what algorithms you are preferring, or you can suggest, or you can suggest your own algorithm also for morphing, or for any other application, I mean. Object recognition, like suppose you are traveling somewhere around and you see some monument and you don't know what it is. So what you can do is you just take a picture of that monument, and you upload it onto the application. Like you, many others also may be visiting the same place. They might have also taken the picture of the same monument. and they might have written some blog, or they might have written some article and might have uploaded onto the website. So what this application will do, it will match your picture with the pictures available onto the net, and it will extract the relevant information from that, maybe some good blog or some articles describing that particular monument. Okay, so you are uploading the picture and application will return the article about it, so you can come to know about that monument on the spot. Okay, that this is Space Needle or X or Y or what. Fine, so this can happen in real time. You can design your own application also. Video summarization is also a very interesting application. This is just a framework, but let me show you that this is just an example of one sport. It's a cricket. It could be a hockey or soccer or any other game. So nobody will like to watch entire match. Fine, if it's a test, then it's a 5-day match. If it's a 1-day, then it may be a 7-hour game. So nobody has that much time. So if something can be done on this, and if we can generate the highlight or the summary of this, like a chapter summary, we can have a summary of this video also. So you have some black box, or you can say you have a video summarization algorithm. You give this big video as an input to the algorithm, and algorithm will identify which are the interesting events, maybe boundaries, maybe sixers, wicket falls, some gestures by umpire. Okay, so those interesting events it will automatically identify, or you can say something like it will generate highlight out of this. So even if your match is of 7 hours, summarization algorithm might create a clip of maybe 5 or 10 minute or 15 minute of that. Okay, which will cover all interesting events of the entire match. Okay, so that can be done. You can create time lapse as well as hyperlapse out of the images. Fine. So this is way in different ways you can do the video summarization. Another application is object tracking, where you can actually track the object. So the leftmost application show it is tracking the pedestrian. Okay. So normally, the flow of pedestrian you can calculate from this, okay, that there are approximately 8 to 9 on an average pedestrians on this area are maybe 50. During 12 to 1, it becomes 20. During 7 to 8, it goes to the peak. Maybe there may be 100 pedestrian. You can also get the average movement, that they are moving at 2 feet per second or 1 foot per second rate. So if something fishy is happening, okay, someone is stealing some items and he's running, or suppose all people are running in randomly in one or another direction, so that indicates that something wrong is happening in this area. Okay, so according to that, you can trigger some movement also. You can inform to the police, or you can activate the cameras which will track those running persons in real time. You might have seen in Hollywood movies, right? Like cars are moving, and cameras on different places are tracking that car. So that type of task can be done. Next, so the next clip that is in middle shows the tracking of players. Okay, players are running and cameras are, the application actually is tracking the persons. So from that, you can do lots of analysis that how persons are running, how close they are to each other. Okay, so that will be useful later on for the analysis. The third clip is tracking the vehicles. So from this, we can get the idea of vehicle density on particular region. Okay? So by this, you can actually improve your RTO system also. Okay, like nowadays, all the signals are having a static timers, maybe 60 seconds timer or 120 second timer. So what happens? Flow of vehicle will not be uniform in all the direction. Fine, it depends on peak hours or normal hours, that sometimes flow may be high from left to right, but it will be very less from left to right. Got it? So you should not have a unique timer for all the direction. If flow is higher for that particular direction, that the timer should be on for larger time. Okay. And if flow is less, then it should be for lower time. So just by tracking the vehicle, we can get the idea that what is the flow of vehicle in all the directions. Fine. On traffic signal, we can install camera in all 4 directions, and we can monitor such flow of the vehicle, and we can actually control the timers based on vehicle density. So, and that will be a dynamic process. Okay, so maybe possible that from left to right, it may be open for 1 minute in morning, but it may become 2 minute in evening, because in evening that will be on peak. Okay, that density will be more. So that kind of automatic management is possible through this kind of tracking applications. This is 3D modeling application. Google is using it. Okay, you can see that on net also, that you can actually get the 3D view also of map. Next is photo tourism. This is also now very popular application, like a virtual tour you can have for different places, maybe for Taj Mahal or Parliament or Colosseum or many other such renowned locations. So what is happening? People are roaming around. They are taking the pictures like anything, and all are uploading on different social medias. Fine. So and all pictures may be taken from different angles with different height and all. So there will be a big cluster of picture of same monument. Say for example, Statue of Liberty. So there might be thousands of pictures of this Statue of Liberty available on net. So you can write an application which will retrieve all the pictures of Statue of Liberty. And then you can write an algorithm which will stitch all these images, and out of that, it will generate a 3D model of that. Okay, like 3D model of Colosseum. All these images are 2D, in fact. But using some tool or using some application, you can create a 3D view, as well as you can add some motions also in that. Okay, you can have actual virtual walk inside this, because you see each and every part of it available onto the net. So you can have a close up, you can have a zoom in, zoom out, or even you can rotate it and you can show each and everything. Okay? But for that, you need a lot of knowledge of image stitching and panorama view and all. But this is possible, what I mean to say is. Smart car is no wonder nowadays. Okay, Google has launched this car in US, as well as Tesla is also popular for this field. So many cameras, many sensors are installed into this car, and it is continuously monitoring the objects which are in front of it, objects which are in back of it and sideways. It is also monitoring distance and all. And based on that, it will take the decision, okay, whether I should speed up or I should speed it down. And you just have to enter the source and destination location into the Google Map. And based on the optimal path, this car will take the route and it will take you to the destination. But though it's a wonderful innovation, it has too many limitations, too many. Fine, because it requires a lot of attention for the infrastructures. Special type of infrastructures are required to make it successful into the market. In robotics also, image processing is like a heart. Like when NASA has sent a Mars Spirit rover onto the Mars, it is not possible to communicate with this device. So this picture is of Mars rover, which was sent on Mars. So it is impossible to communicate with this from Earth, right? So there are some cameras are installed here. If you can see, a lot of cameras are installed here. Some machine learning and some artificial intelligence algorithms were installed into the chip. And based onto the vision of this camera, this was moving onto the surface of Mars. It was taking the pictures and was sending the pictures onto the Earth. Right? So whatever pictures it was taking, based on that, it was seeing how surface looks like. Okay, what kind of environment is there? So many sensors were available on this. So it was recording all the things. What is the temperature? What is humidity? What is wind speed and all? But what I mean to say is that so you can consider this cameras as an eye of this Mars Spirit rover. So it was simply looking at front, and it decides whether surface is smooth or not, if some obstacle is present or not. And based on that, it was taking the movement. Similarly, one very popular event that is called RoboCup. So where robots will take part into this event, It's probably, and some games may be given, maybe football or soccer kind of things. And both are same, football or maybe some other game. And based on the vision of this cameras installed into the robot's eye, robots will take the decision. So they are instantly, or they are processing whatever they are seeing in real time. And based on that, they will take the movements. So a lot of artificial intelligence, machine learning, and image processing is involved into this. In medical field also, image processing is like indivisible part. Right? X-rays, CT scan, MRIs, and so many other guided surgeries, they would be simply impossible without image processing. This kind of panorama views also you can generate with the help of image processing. If you have a knowledge of camera, then you would understand that if you have a wide-angle lens, very wide-angle lens, then only it is possible to capture this kind of shot. Okay? Otherwise, you will end up with some part of this. If you don't have a wide-angle lens, you will end up with some part of this. Now see that some part of this image does not look good. You can see it in top row. If you look at individual image in top row, they are not that much interesting. Fine. So, but you can't have a wider view because you have limitations of your camera. But what you can do is you capture all these images side by side. Okay. So you have a lot of such images and you can feed it to the software or the tool, which will perform image registration and image stitching, and it will create a nice panorama view for you. Okay. And this is very popular. Now Google Photos is also having this functionality. When you have taken many photographs side by side, and if you are uploading into the Google Photos, then Google Photo will automatically process it and it will give you the panorama view for that. So you can write your own application to generate panoramas. This is the example of image stitching. See, no camera can have this kind of zooming effect. Okay. So what one artist has done is, he has taken 105 different exposure images, 105 different images, and he has stitched those images in such a way so that he got the overall resolution of 620 megapixel, which is impossible to capture through any camera. Okay, 620 megapixel. You see that the level of zooming and zoom out effect he has achieved in this. You just focus on one point. Okay, say for example, this house. You see that, where it is going. Okay, so this kind of image also you can create through image processing. When you have improper equipments or improper weather, you might often end up with noisy images or maybe blurry images. Fine, some dots may be present onto the image or some blurriness may be present into the images. So through the applications of image processing, you can recover them. So the top row indicates the noisy image and bottom row indicates the processed image. Okay. So this is having some out of focus image. This is out of focus image and this is a sharp image. Okay. This is noisy image. It is corrupted with paper and salt image, paper and salt noise. And you see that that effect has been reduced quite a lot. And this is having a motion, or you can say it's having a Gaussian motion. So that has been restored. And now you just look at this number plate of this vehicle. Okay, you can't read anything out of this, but after processing, you see it's clearly visible. So this kind of techniques or tricks could be useful in some cases, maybe for number plate recognition. Okay, if some thief is running away, and when camera captures the moving objects, definitely it will be blurred. Okay? So by restoration technique, we can actually get the actual image. So if even not exact, but we can get the near to the exact one. Many pattern recognition applications are there in which you can apply the image processing, like optical character recognition, face recognition, fingerprint recognition, facial expression recognition, fine, number plate recognition. Even you can apply it on speech recognition, crop disease prediction, like looking at the leaf of the crop. And many such applications are available for Android and iOS also, that you just have to click the leaf of the plant and that will go to the server. Server will do some processing. It will analyze the leaves and it will send some appropriate message to the farmer that your crop has been infected by this and this kind of disease, and you should take this kind of preventional steps. And food quality control, you can also do with the help of camera and image processing. So camera will be continuously monitoring the flow of apples, and it will process this texture on this apple. And based on to the texture, it will determine the quality of the food. So still there is a big list of image processing applications is there, but these are the some of the applications I wanted to highlight. So it will just give you some brief interest in image processing, that where image processing stands and where you can utilize it. Right? So let's move ahead. We'll discuss some basic types of images into this section. So like analog and digital signal, images also comes in digital and analog form. So before I talk about image, let me talk brief about a signal. So on right hand side image, I have shown two signal. One is black, that is a continuous signal, or you can say it's an analog signal. And the second one is shown into this bar. Okay, this is shown in bar. So this is called a digital signal. Now, what is the difference? In continuous signal or analog signal, if you pick up any value in y direction or any random value in x direction, signal will be definitely present, okay, within the given range. Suppose this is the amplitude of this up to this. Then from zero to its amplitude, you pick up any real number. Any real number between zero to one can have an infinite samples. Okay, zero to one, you take the gap of just one. Even 0 to 1, there will be infinite samples, 0, 0.1, 0.001, 0.0001, 0.123, 0.1013, 0.1013, any random value. So there are such infinite possibilities are there. And if you pick up any of this infinite possibility, you will definitely get some amplitude of the signal there. Similarly, if you sample in x direction, so if you pick up any value on this x-axis, and if you project it in upward direction, definitely signal will be present. And definitely we will find the signal. It means in analog signal, at any random position, signal is present. Its amplitude is present. Fine. So to store an analog signal of just 1 millisecond or 2 millisecond on a 1 terabyte hard disk is also impossible. You can say that because there are infinite signals. And 1 terabyte is again a limited space. 2 TB is again a limited space. Okay? So it is impossible to store even a very, very small signal on such a huge memory space. Fine. So what we need to do is we have to sample that signal. What do we mean by sampling? Instead of selecting all the representative, all the values of that signal, we will select values at particular locations only. And that will represent the signal. Okay, so you can see that here, let me take the pen. We might select this point onto this signal. We might select this point onto the signal. Okay, so only these points now we have to store instead of infinite samples. So these points are selected in such a way so that it will show the nature of the signal. Okay? From this point also, we can easily identify that original signal would be something like a sinusoidal. Okay? There is no need to store all infinite samples. What I'm doing is I'm just selecting few samples of this out of this infinite samples. And still, I can easily predict what would be the shape of original signal. Then, so now this is called a discrete one. Sorry, this is now become, it is now discrete. You see that it is not having a value at any random location. It has value at some 0.0, 0.1, 0.2, 0.3 only. In between, information is missing. Okay. Similarly, when you sample it in vertical direction, it has amplitude at this value. It has amplitude at this value. There is no amplitude present in this range. Got it? So we are quantizing signal and we are sampling signal. Fine. We are digitizing its partial location also, as well as its amplitude also. So that is called digital one. Now, what is the advantage of digital signal is that as now it is a discrete, it is a finite, we can easily store it onto the hard disk. Okay, we require very less amount for this. So storage is very simple. We can easily reproduce the signal. Okay, if you generate a discrete signal from the analog signal with certain sampling rate, then you can always generate back the analog signal from the digital one. So storing is also very easy, as well as processing also becomes very simple. Fine. You require less memory, you require less computational power if it is in digital format. Fine. So image comes in two flavor, analog and digital. But whatever processing, whatever images we are seeing around us on mobile phone, on camera, on scanner, anywhere, they all are in digital form, remember. Because computers understand only 0-1, binary only. So whatever we are storing in computer, it is always digital, remember. So whatever is on mobile phone, whatever is in laptop, on computer, they all are digital images. Even if it is a video or anything, it's always in digital form. Fine. Because it is impossible to store and process analog signal. Even millisecond signal is also very hard to process. Remember that. Fine. So we will be focusing on digital part only. Okay. Analog part will be for electronics and communication branch. Okay. Because they are working with the actual analog signals like AM, AFM, and many other different rays. But we are into the digital part. So the very basic type of image is a binary image. Okay? So binary image, as the name suggests, binary. Okay? So it is having only bi-level, that is either black or zero. Okay? So we required only one bit for this. Okay? We required. So if you don't know, let me tell you that image is nothing but it's a grid of pixels. So if this is your image, then you can consider it as a two-dimensional array of pixels like this. So it is having some n number of rows and m number of columns. Okay, so this is one image where each cell represents one pixel. Okay, so this is one pixel. Now, if it is a binary image, this pixel can have value either zero or it can take value one. Only one of the two possibilities are there. If that value is set to zero, then that pixel appears black. If it is set to one, then that pixel appears white. It means we required only one bit for this. If you want to generate binary image, you required one bit per pixel. Remember that one bit per pixel memory is required. So bit can take two value, either zero or one. Fine. So with one bit, you are getting two different intensity levels, either zero or one, that is either black or white. Okay. So if you are setting these values one, it means these values will appear as a white in image. Okay. So image is a visual representation, but in background, it is nothing but it's a simple two-dimensional array of intensities. Okay. It's an array of numbers. So you set the numbers and you will get the image. That's very simple. So see that some part of this region is highlighted here. And see, there is some white edges are present in middle, and it is nothing but 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. Okay? So that formed this kind of shape. And rest of all are zero. So the entire background here is black. Clear? So it should not be too difficult to understand what is binary image, how image looks like. Again, I'm repeating, just remember, image is nothing but it's a two-dimensional array where each cell represents intensity of the pixel, or you can say that it is a collection of pixels, or it is a grid of pixels where each cell indicates intensity of the pixel. So what value we are storing here, that will determine how your image looks like or how your pixel will look like. But right now we are talking on about binary image. So binary image can take only zero or one value, remember. So zero for black, one for white. Pretty clear? Next, another is a grayscale image. So you see that, see the difference. This is a binary image, so everything is black and white. This is grayscale image, so you can see that it is having a pure white intensity also, pure black intensity also, as well as it is having a very nice gray shades. Fine. It is having very nice gray shades. Now see, gray shade image or grayscale images are encoded with 8-bit per pixel. 8-bit per pixel. Binary image was encoded with 1-bit per pixel. So 1-bit can take maximum two different values, either 0 or 1. If there are 8-bit, then how many possibilities are there? Can anybody answer? If we have 8 different bits to represent the color, how many different colors or how many different shades are possible?
Students, please type your answers in the chat box.
Okay, so they might not have access to audio. Anyway, chat box. Two raised to it, exactly. Fine. Nice. 2^8, that is 256 different combinations are possible. So if you have a grayscale image, then this pixel can take one of the 256 different values. Okay? So if I set all 8 pixels to 0, okay? See, I have 8 different bits are available to represent intensity of 1 pixel. So if I set all 8 bit values to 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, then the decimal equivalent of this will be 0. Fine. If I set all 8 bit to 11111, then decimal equivalent of this is 255. So grayscale image, pixel in grayscale image can take minimum value 0, maximum 255. So if it is 0, it represents black color. If it is 255, it represents pure white color. And any number in between 0 and 255 will represent different shades of gray. Remember that. Okay. So you can consider something like this. It is an axis where this is 0, indicates complete black. Here it is 255, it's complete white. Okay. And in between here, we have a 128. So that will be a gray tone between 0 and 255. It means you are mixing equal proportion of white and black color so that you will get a pure gray. If you are moving in this direction, you will get brighter and brighter gray. If you are moving in this direction, you will get darker and darker shade of gray. Is that clear? So when you look at any number, see, this is 67 and this is 251. So it is very obvious that this pixel will appear brighter than this one because it is having intensity value 67. So it will be darker and this is near to 255. So it will be very, very brighter here. Similarly, 155 and 189. So this pixel will be brighter than this, clear? And 150 will be brighter than this, 129 will be even brighter than this. Got it? So just by setting, so you can form your own image also. What you have to do is you initialize one array of some size m by n, and you put some numbers between 0 to 255 on all the cells, and using some image processing display tool, you just load your variable and it will appear as an image, clear? So image is quite a simpler concept. It's just an array. But depending on how many bits you are allocating for the pixel, depending on that, you will have a different images, binary image, grayscale image, and the third one and very popular one is color image. So in color image, there will be a three planes, red, green, and blue. And individual plane are a grayscale plane. So the red value can be between 0 to 255. Green intensity can be also between 0 to 255, and blue can also be between 0 to 255. Now, all three planes are superimposed on each other. Okay. And when you put all these planes on each other, the resultant image will appear as a color image. Now, what will happen? See, for the first pixel, the red intensity is 49, green intensity is 64, and blue intensity is 66. So what ultimately will happen? That you are taking some proportion of red whose concentration is 49%. In that you are adding a green color with the saturation 64. In that you are adding a blue with the saturation 66%. and mix of that will appear as a first pixel here. Are you getting? So whenever all three, suppose we are talking about the last pixel, if all these three values are 255, 255, 255, we will get pure white pixel. If all these three pixels are zero, intensity are 0, 0, 0, we will get pure black color. And if they have any random value between 0 to 255, we will get different shades based on to the proportion of the color. So typically, the color is represented by triplet. Okay. RGB color so is often represented by this triplet, RGB. So if I write like this, 255, 0, 0, it indicates the saturation of red is 255, green is 0, blue is 0. So ultimately, this pixel will appear as a pure red. Okay. It will appear as a pure red. If I do something like this, I'm setting this intensity to 255 and I'm making it 0, then it will appear it as a pure green. Fine. If I do something like this, 0, 255, 255. What it means? Red is fully saturated, blue is also fully saturated. So when you mix red and blue, what color you will get? That will be magenta. Fine. So that pixel will appear as a magenta, and that also in full saturation. It will be pure color. But if I'm doing something like this, 127 of this, 127 of this. So again, I will get the magenta color, but now its saturation has been reduced to 50% only. Are you getting? I am using just the red and blue only, but now its saturation is less. I am using them with only their 50% saturation level. So it will be magenta, but it will be dull. It will not be that bright. Got it? And if I'll make it like this, 127, 127, 127, when all three colors are in equal proportion, you will always get grayscale. Remember that. If they are 0, 0, 0, pure black, 255, 255, 255, pure white. And for any other combination of equal proportion, 3, 3, 3, 10, 10, 10, 100, 100, 100, 80, 80, 80, it will give you the simply grayscale color, gray color of that particular intensity. Is that clear? Okay. Can anybody tell me that how many different colors are possible in color image? So whatever images we are using on our mobile phone or on computer screen, they all are color image. Can you tell me how many different color combinations are possible for color image? You know how many bits are required. Okay, this is individually a grayscale image. This is also a separate grayscale image. This is also grayscale. And you already know how to represent a grayscale image or how many bits are required to represent each pixel. So any comment on this? How many different shades are possible for, yeah, what is sRGB and Adobe RGB in laptop screen? Now see, RGB, there are different adapters are available. Like VGA adapter, some XVGA adapters are available. So all are having a different sensitivity towards the color. Okay, if you have a same color palette, if you show it to a normal person, and when you show it to the colorblind person, then both will perceive the colors in different manner. Similarly, whatever adapters we have, they are having a different capability of sensing the color and representing the color. Fine. So this sRGB and RGB are different such kind of, you can say they are a different palette. Even though they are RGB, they might have some variations in shades. Okay? Even there are many such options are available, color models are available, RGB color model, CMYK color model, HSI color model, HSV color model. So they are perceiving it in some different way. That's all. Yeah. So my question was, how many different color combinations are possible in color image, or how many different variations are possible for one pixel? Like in binary, it was 2, either 0 or 1. In grayscale, it was 256, either 0 or 1 or 2 or up to 255. So similarly, can you tell me how many different shades are possible for any pixel in color image? Any guess? Sorry, I forgot to scroll. 167. Yeah, exactly. Fine. So this is the correct number. And how do we got that? See, for red, we have 256 different combinations possible. For green also, there are 256 combinations are possible. And for blue also, there are 256 different combinations are possible. Okay, so that ultimately 1677216. Or in another way, we have an 8-bit to encode red channel. We have an 8-bit to encode green channel. And we have a 8-bit to encode blue channel. So we have total 24 bits per pixel available for color image. And if you have a 24 bits, then different possible combinations are how many? 2^24. Okay. That's nothing but approximately 17 million different colors. Clear? So your JPEG, in your JPEG image, one pixel can have one of the 17 million different possible colors. Okay. 17 million different colors are possible. And there is another system which is called True Color System. They are utilizing 32 bits per pixel. So you just imagine the range of color. Okay, our human eye cannot distinguish more than 256 colors if they are in a same range. Okay, so it means if I have a different shades of red lay by side by side, I might not be able to distinguish them. Fine, I can have a maximum up to 256, but not more than that. Fine, and we have 32 bit such a system is available. That is, we have totally 2^32 different such shades are present into that image. And the fourth one is an indexed image. Now, what happens in indexed image? Instead of, see, in all previous images, we were storing actual intensity here. But now we will have a color palette here. Okay, a big color palette will be stored into the system, and it is storing all different possible colors here as a triplet, RGB. You can see that this is R, then G, this is B. These all are normalized. That's why they are in zero, between 0 to 1, okay? Divided by 255. So they will be normalized. That's why it is between 0 to 1. So all possible colors are here. Now what happens? All are indexed. This is having index 1 color, index 2 color, index 3 color, and some index some M color. Now if on this pixel, you want to show color represented by this triplet, then there is no need to write down three numbers here. Instead of what you will do is that color is on index number 4. So that index you are writing here instead of color. Okay. Suppose on this particular location, I want to display this color. Okay. So instead of writing a triplet of that color here, what I need to do is I just have to find out what is the index of that color into that color palette. That is 3, 4, 5, and this may be a 6th index. So I have to store here 6 instead of color. Now, what is the advantage of this system? See, are you following this? What is happening is, instead of writing colors, what I'm doing is I'm just writing the index of that color. And color I am storing as a separate palette. So can you tell me what is the advantage of this kind of representation? You can write down in chat box. Let me check it. If anybody has answered. Yeah, no. Let me tell you that the thing is that now instead of storing three values, we need to store only one value. Fine. We just have to store here index. It means it will take quite less memory compared to your JPEG image. Some notification I got. Processing is faster. No, it is exactly reverse. The advantage is that you require less memory for storing this image. Maybe possible that, see, if this ostrich we have to represent using JPG or color image representation, then instead of 4, what we have to do is we have to store 3 values. Maybe it's color 24, some 38, and some 64. This we have to store here. But now we have to store only one number, that is 4. Okay, and on 4, whatever color is there, that will be replaced onto that particular first pixel. So if we are using a color image, we might end up with 3 times memory. Fine. Instead of one number, we have to store 3 numbers. So color image may take 3 times memory compared to indexed image. So the advantage we are getting is the compactness or the less memory. But the downside is that it will take a lot of processing time. Because suppose I want to load this array and I want to see what image it is representing. So what will happen? First, the tool which is showing the image, which is used to show the image, it will first read 4 here, and then it will go to this lookup table and it will fetch that number and it will display the appropriate color for the first pixel. Then it will pick up the second number. This is 5. So again, it will go into the fifth location. It will pick up this combination of color and it will display onto the second pixel. So for all pixels, it has to do this. Fine. So accessing image is quite time consuming compared to the color image. So indexed image are rarely used, very, very rarely used. Because when memory was the issue, indexed image was good choice. But now we have a very costly memory. Sorry, we have very cheap memory compared to the previous era. Fine, you can easily install SSD or RAM on your system. So it's always very convenient to store your image as a color image compared to the indexed one, because the processing indexed one will take more time. Okay, I hope I have made the point clear. 5 indexed images are rare now. Okay, mostly we are dealing with grayscale image or the color image. These are the fundamental two types of images we are dealing with. This is a Lena image. I am not talking about this scanner right now. This lady is known as a Lena. Lena, she was a model. And this image is perhaps the most popular image into the history of image processing. You pick up any book of image processing and you will find this image into that book. The reason is that this image is having almost all the properties which you need to execute your image processing algorithms. It is having a pure white color. It is having pure black color. It is having a gray shades. It is having a dark shades, lighter shades. Almost all shades are possible. It is having a rough areas. It is having a smoother areas. It is having a shadow. Okay. It is having a different intensity levels. Almost all things are available. Smooth patches are also present, as well as some noisy patches are also present. So almost all properties are there. It means you can run your all type of image processing algorithm on this virtually. Fine. That's why this image is very popular. And this, let's skip this discussion. You can read on this URL about this Lena. Okay. wikipedia.org/wiki/Lena. Okay, so you will get all information about her. She was actually invited in many conferences and many such workshops on image processing also. But that's a different story. Okay, so any confusion so far, anyone? You can write down your doubts here in chat box. I'll be replying them and then we'll go ahead. I'll wait for 1 minute and then I'll switch back to the presentation. Meanwhile, if you have any query, feel free to ask. Fine, it seems no query, but you just start visualizing image, how it looks like. Okay. So if you have a one paper, so that's grayscale image. Okay. If you have a three papers, okay, yeah, one image. Sir, what about image taken by telescope in space? What about, that is not clear to me. What about that means what you want to ask? Fine, you have a time. You can reformulate your question. I'll come back to this. What exactly you want to ask is, fine, images can be created in different ways. You can create it using mobile DSLR cameras, or even you can have it through scanner, or even you can synthesize the images on computer also. And even you can capture it by some satellites, telescopes, and all. But I'm not clear about this question. Please reformulate it. I'll get back to this. Meanwhile, let's move ahead. Fundamentals of the images. So there is very popular saying, a picture is worth 1,000 words. And it's 1,000% true. Fine, many times we fail to express the emotion or the intensity of the event. Even by writing the thousands of words or even by writing entire chapter, we may fail to describe or express the intensity or the emotions of some event. But just by having a look at that picture, we can actually feel what is happening or what is going on that. Fine, so this is the World Cup winning moment for the India. So obviously, you can't describe the intensity on the field in words. But look at the picture, it describes everything. Fine. Similarly, the emotions of this Mona Lisa, it's priceless. You cannot describe it by words, but one picture will tell you a lot of stories. Fine. So there are many related terms like computer graphics, image processing, and computer vision. So I'll just give you the one definition. I am not going into much detail of this. Like in computer graphics, we are mostly converting our 3D objects into 2D. In computer vision, our input is 2D and we are making it to the 3D. And in image processing, our input is 2D. We are doing some processing and we are converting back into the 2D. Okay, so it is a somewhat processed image, we can say. But this is not the exact definition. This is quite fuzzy definition. Okay, so they all are, again, intermixing fields. You cannot clearly separate. It means you cannot represent image processing, computer vision, and computer graphics like this. Rather, you can or you should view them as something like this, okay? Intersection. Okay? Some part is mixing with each other. So there is no clear-cut boundary between all this. But this is the, you can say, higher level distinction between them. Yeah, this could be important for you to understand. This is entire image processing pipeline. These are the steps you might need at a different level in different applications. The first step is image acquisition. As I said, image acquisition can be done in different ways. Either you can generate your image through mobile or camera or maybe through a scanner, or you might generate it on computer and so on, maybe satellite image. Once you have acquired the images, images may not be in good quality. So you need to perform some enhancement onto the image. And you must have observed it many times when you click the image, the lighting condition may not be proper or there may be too much of sunlight. Fine. So your image appears very dull, or whenever you are taking image from the top, maybe from mountain. So there may be a lot of air turbulence into the images. So you need to enhance those images. So there is a step for image enhancement. So you can apply some different filtering techniques. You can apply some histogram equalization, maybe contrast enhancement, fine. Maybe brightness adjustment, and many more other tools are available. There is one more technique that is called image restoration, in which we are identifying what is the source of image capturing and what is the source of image what was the source which was corrupting your image. And based on that estimation, you can restore back your original image. If you know that while I was taking the image, I was in car. So obviously there will be some motion, okay? And your image will be blurred and that will be a motion blur. So if you know that this is due to motion, you can always restore back it. Okay, so you can come back to, or you can retrieve the crisp image. Then there are many morphological operations. Morphological operations are dealing with your thinning and thickening of your image to find the boundary of the image. Okay? So there are a very big list of algorithms are available for the morphological processing. There comes segmentation. You can divide your image into different segments based on color coding. Fine. Like when you take the satellite image, then those images processed and they are converted into color code. Like vegetation area is shown by some light green color, jungle area is shown by some, forest area is shown by some dark green color, water surfaces are shown by blue color. So that is nothing but it's a segmentation. Okay. Based on to the characteristics of the pixels, different color codes are assigned, and so that it is easy to interpret the image. That is called segmentation. Object recognition. So once you segment the area of the image, you can apply some recognition algorithm on that. And you can identify whether this object is a car or whether this object is a scooter or bus or aeroplane or whatever. So different objects you can recognize. And once object is recognized, you can represent it using its descriptor. Fine. Different descriptors are available, but all this, see, it is impossible to cover any of this topic in this literature, in this session, because they all are a big topic themselves. But this is just for introduction. And most of this work we are doing on grayscale image. Very few work is focused on color images. Fine. And there is a separate topic that is called image compression. You can apply some compression algorithm and you can save your space. There is some continuously we are surrounded with different types of signal, but every time we not be able to hear them. Human have a, I mean, every animal has a fixed range of audible signals. Okay, if the signal has a frequency in range of 20 to 20,000 hertz, then only human can listen it. Okay, human can hear it. If it is below 20 or above 20,000, the audible signal is there, signal is existing, but we are not able to listen it because it is out of our the range of our ear. So whatever signals dolphin can hear or bat can hear or mouse can hear, human cannot, because the range of human is up to just 20,000. Here it is 1 lakh, 1 lakh 20,000, 1 lakh 30,000, and so on. Okay. So those signals dolphin can hear, but we cannot. Similarly, some ranges which are less than 20. So mosquito or some bees can hear them, but we cannot. Okay. So there is a fixed range for audible signals to the human. Similarly, what we can hear, maybe some other animal may not be able to hear them. Got it? So just like audible signal or audible range, there is a visible range. So just like signals, we are always surrounded by different rays. You already know the names like gamma rays, X-rays, ultraviolet, infrared rays, microwave, fine, radio waves. So all are traveling around us, but we are not able to see them. Fine. See, when we go to take the X-ray, so there is an X-ray machine installed there. So here on top of that, there will be X-ray machine. There will be a plate. On plate, patient will lie, okay? And there will be some plate, metal detector plate here. So X-rays are fired from this machine, okay? And they will pass through the body of the patient, and there will be some material here, okay? Some sheet here. So it will take the projection of this patient's body on this surface. So if you have observed, when X-rays are fired, we are not able to see them. Fine. But definitely we can see the effect of X-ray on this material. So X-ray does exist. They have traveled from the source to the destination, but we are not able to see them. Similarly, whenever we are talking on phone, okay, whenever we are talking on phone, they are all radio waves. So the signals coming out from this is radio waves. Whatever radios we are listening, AM and FM. So whatever songs are being played on that. So they are nothing but they are a type of signals. Okay, they are traveling through the air and coming to the antenna of our radio. And then we are able to listen them. Right? So different type of rays are available. We are always surrounded by this kind of rays all the time. But we are not able to see them. Fine. So what we can see is this part. So this is called EM spectrum, electromagnetic spectrum. Okay, this entire spectrum is called EM, electromagnetic spectrum. So in this spectrum, as you move in this direction from left to right, frequency of signal will decrease. Okay, and the wavelength will increase because frequency and wavelength are inversely proportional. So as we go in this direction, you can see that here visual representation is shown. The frequency is gradually decreasing, but wavelength is increasing. Got it? So gamma rays are having the maximum frequency and radio waves are having the minimum frequency. And the rays which are having a higher frequency are more dangerous. Okay? They are more dangerous. And signals are having a less frequency are less dangerous. You can think like that. And that's why these gamma rays and X-rays are very dangerous to us. We should not expose our body to such kind of signals because they fall in very high frequency range. Okay? So many times, if you have observed, no person or very limited persons are allowed when X-ray is to be taken. Fine? Because human organs are very sensitive to this gamma rays and X-rays. So they are typically not used in communication. They are only used for very specific purpose in medical. Fine. Then there comes ultraviolet rays. Ultraviolet rays are used for very short communication. Okay? Infrared rays are also used for communication, but typically they are used in television, remote. Okay. Remotes are operated by this IR. And the range between this, from 400 nanometer to 700 nanometer. Okay? If signal is having frequency between wavelength between 400 nanometer to 700 nanometer, then only those signals will be visible to us. Just like this. See, all type of signals are always around us, whether it's audible or visible. But if it is in range between 10 to 20,000, we can hear them. Else they exist, but we cannot hear. Similarly, we are always surrounded by different type of such rays, maybe radio waves, microwaves, infrared rays. See, when you change the channel through the remote, fine. So definitely some infrared rays have been passed, and that's why its channel has been changed. But we are not able to see that ray. What is the reason? Because the wavelength of that infrared ray is higher than the 700 nanometer. Clear? Similarly, when you do some data transfer using UV, then also we are not able to see any rays, but rays exist. Okay, rays are there, but we are not able to see them because they have a frequency or wavelength less than 400. So whatever we are seeing around us, maybe wall, fan, computer, laptop screen, mobile, okay, curtains, anything around us, whatever we are seeing, they are continuously, light fall on all these objects. And objects are only visible because they are reflecting some light and light is reaching to our eye. I am repeating. Whenever you are in very much dark, complete dark room, nothing is visible. All objects are there, but still they are not visible. But when you switch on the light, everything will be visible. What is the reason? Whenever you are in dark room, no rays will reflect from the surface of the objects and nothing will reach to our eye. And hence we are not able to see them. But when you switch on some light source, light will fall into the objects and those objects will reflect some of the lights back to the viewer. Okay? And hence we are able to see them. Now the color of that objects depend on what wavelength of light is being reflected to the viewer. Okay? Suppose whatever objects you are watching, if it is reflecting the light of near around 700 nanometer wavelength, then that object will appear as a red. If it is reflecting light rays, which are having a wavelength near about 400 nanometer, then it will appear as a blue. Got it? Even though white light is falling on that, it will absorb some light and it will reflect some light. Got it? And that's why we will see different objects with different colors. That's because of these characteristics. So remember, visible spectrum only is visible. Okay, rest of all, we can't see. And the size is shown here, like gamma rays are very, very small. The 10^-12 meter is the wavelength, is the size of this. It is about of size atomic nucleus. X-rays are having size 10^-10 meter, and they have a size of like atoms. Ultraviolet, they look like a molecules. Visible range, that is a protozoans. Infrared are bigger than that, like a needle points. Microwaves can have a size of butterfly 10^-2. And in between this, it's radio waves are having the highest wavelength. Okay. Even they can jump the buildings. Okay, even they can jump the larger buildings. 10 raised to 3 is the size of its one cycle. So that is 1,000. So it's quite big. And that's why even there is obstacle available, the radio signals can easily pass through the buildings, and we can listen the voice of person who is very, very far away. Fine. Because they can penetrate the obstacles, they can jump the obstacles. But infrared cannot jump the obstacle. So if you put some obstacle between your TV sensors and remote, you won't be able to change the channel, because the signals wavelength is very small. They cannot jump that obstacle. Fine. That is the reason it requires line of sight communication, LOS communication. Why digital format? I have talked that it could be either digital image or the analog image. And mostly we are dealing with the digital image. The reason is that exactness, like you can reproduce the image, you can always duplicate the image if it is in digital format. It is very convenient and powerful computer-aided processing. You can write down so many different software routines for that. I can write down many software for that to process those images. Like the basic, starting from the MS Paint, you have a Microsoft PowerPoint, you have a higher level of softwares like Picasa, Google Photos, maybe Photoshop, maybe Adobe Premiere. Fine. Many such tools are available to process the image and videos, and it allows very easy storage and transmission. You can run some image compression algorithms to reduce the size, and you can transmit them without much disturbance. Okay. So whatever image you are transmitting, same will be retrieved on other end also, because it is in digital form. But when you are transmitting analog, there are more chances of tear and wear into the signal. So this is what I wanted to convey, that image is nothing but it's an array of intensity values, something like this. Okay. So some part of that is highlighted here, and even that part is zoomed in. So see that this first pixel is quite white, second is quite white, this one it bit gray, and this one is dark gray. So when you look at the intensity, you will get the idea. 255, 254, 255, so they are almost white. This is 165, so this is a bit gray, and 107, it is darker. So as your intensity approaches to zero, your pixel will become darker and darker. At zero, it will become complete black. And as intensity approaches to 255, intensity of pixel will become brighter and brighter, and at 255, it will become complete white. And this is the representation of color image. The bottom one is the grayscale. Top one is the color one. So in grayscale image, we required only one number to represent the grayscale level. But in case of color image, we required three values. Now say it is 208, 128, and 9. So blue component is almost missing, and red is dominating. And that's why you can see that this color of all these three pixels is bit reddish. Okay, maybe brown or but reddish. But red is dominant color. Fine, because as well here you see it's 140 and 97 and 11. So green is also having a quite good proportion in this. So it is not that much reddish. Okay. So it is having a three colors per pixel, whereas in case of grayscale, there is only one intensity value for per pixel. This is how to compute the size. I'm skipping this, and that is not important. I'm showing you some of the processing techniques to correct your image or to enhance your image. So actually I won't be able to show it on MATLAB right now, but I have this nice images. So see what I have done is I have created one array with intensity 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And then I have stretched this range. So what will happen? This one will become dark, 9 will become white. Okay, this will become black, this will become white, and this will map to appropriate intensity level. Okay. What I have done is the range of 1 to 9, I have stretched to 0 to 255. So 1 will become 0 and 9 will become 255. So I have created image of size 3x3 and I have displayed it. So this image looks like this. Got it? The intensity value 1 will map to black and intensity value 9 will map to complete white. The rest of all are having a different intensities. You see that? As I'm moving from lower to higher, the pixel is becoming brighter and brighter. So this is how you can have your own image. You just put different intensity values and show it using some tool. This is the original LENA image between 0 to 255 intensity range. This I have shown from 0 to 127 only. And this is between 127 to 255. So what I'm doing is I am just squeezing the range of intensity values, and hence I am getting either brighter image or I am getting the darker image. Okay. So what I am doing is I am mapping the entire range of intensity into half of that. So depending on which range I am mapping, I will get darker or the brighter image. This is how to save your image on your hard disk by using different quality parameters. So those who are using Photoshop, they may be knowing this. Suppose whenever you are saving image, by default, it will appear good quality image, okay? Suppose the same operation I'm performing in MATLAB. Okay, so there is a function called IMWrite, okay? And I am passing the quality parameter here. What quality parameter I want to pass? So see that for quality parameter 75, image look quite good. Then I'm changing it to 50. So it starts showing some fuzziness here. For Q is equal to 5, you can clearly see the different segments here. And for Q is equal to 2, you can see that how bad this image is. But what is happening? This image will take maximum memory, this image will take minimum memory. Because as quality parameter is very low, it requires very less number of colors to represent this image. This may require approximately 255 different sheets. So you required 8 bit per pixel. Okay? This might require 7 bit per pixel. This may require might require 5 bit per pixel. This can be shown using just 3 bit per pixel. So there is always a trade-off between quality and the memory. Obviously, when you are allocating more memory, the quality of image will be good because you can show more intensity levels. But if intensity levels are less, you require less memory and quality of image will be bad, poor. This is image resizing. This is the original image, and either you can size up or you can size down. That's very basic operation. I should not discuss it. Sampling process, yeah. So consider that this is the original signal. Okay, this black one is the analog signal. Again, I'm revisiting that analog and digital concept. Now, if I want to store this black signal on the hard disk, it is impossible because it is a continuous signal. So again, it is shown here also. And this above one is the analog signal. Now what I'm doing is I'm only taking some of the samples from this image at regular interval. So what happens? I can get the idea of the shape of original signal. That original signal might look like this. Fine, that is called sampling. Now how many samples you are taking out of this analog signal will determine the quality of your signal or quality of your discrete signal. So I assume that right now I'm taking some n number of samples from the LENA. It's a 128 by 128. So I assume that I'm taking that many signals, samples. So image looks like this. Now I'm reducing the sampling rate by half. It means I'm taking only 50% of the samples. So quality of image looks like this. Okay, it's a 50%. So 128 by 128 has been reduced to 64 by 64. And you can clearly see the difference. Okay, obviously the memory required by this will be 50% compared to this one. Okay, it will be half of this one, but quality is poor. Again, I'm reducing the sampling rate of the image, and again I'm selecting the half of the original one. So this many, you see that very few. Now I'm selecting only 32 by 32 samples only out of this entire signal. Again, I'm reducing it. So you see that as I'm reducing number of samples, the quality of signal or quality of image is decreasing, and the size is also decreasing. Fine, 16 by 16, 32 by 32, 64 by 64, 128 by 128. So this concept is called sampling, and sampling rate should follow the Nyquist criteria. Okay, I don't know whether you have heard this name in your engineering or not, but Nyquist criteria says that you should have sample double than your maximum frequency in your signal. Okay, so suppose this is your signal, how this looks like. So find out the maximum frequency of that signal. Okay, suppose this is the maximum frequency of your signal. So you should have sampling rate double than your this maximum frequency. If you are sampling your signal with this rate, then image quality will be quite good and you will be able to regenerate your original signal. Okay? Anytime you want to regenerate the original signal, it is always possible. We have very less time, so I'm quickly going through this, not discussing this. This is the example of sampling. Okay, the one which I have shown. So this is done in Photoshop. Okay? When you are doing in Photoshop like this, you reduce the size and increase and you perform the zoom in operation. So here we have a 256 by 256 sample. Then we have reduced samples by 50%. And again, I'm zooming it to the original size. Again, I'm reducing the size to half of that. And again, I'm zooming up. Again, I'm reducing to half of that. And again, I'm zooming up. Okay. So you see that what is happening here? The grid of pixel, this square block, will become single pixel here. Okay. Similarly, when I this all the pixels will map to the same pixel into this. Okay. So gradually you will get checkerboard kind of effects. Okay. As you are decreasing your sampling rate, you will start getting checkerboard type of effect because many pixels will become a single pixel. Okay. So actually this could be a block of 16 by 16 pixel in original image. And all 16 pixels, 16 by 16, this all these pixels in this block might have different intensity, and that's why it looks very smooth. But here it becomes only one pixel, and you are getting the block of same color, and that's why this checkerboard effect is. See, this is I'm reducing constantly. So you are getting more and more checkerboard effects. This is what sampling. So your sampling rate should be sufficient. This is what quantization is. Quantization deals with the level of grayscale. So if I am taking only two level, then my image will be black and white. If I am taking it L is equal to 3, so I will have a 2^3, that is 8 different intensity levels. If I am taking quantization level to 4, so I will have 2^4, that is 16 different intensity levels. And when I have a 8-bit, I'm using 8-bit, and I will have 256 different intensity levels. So you see that how nicely image is growing when I have a more number of pixels or more number of quantizations or more number of bit per pixel. Okay. This is the original image in center. And this is how we can increase the brightness, or this is how we can decrease the brightness by adding some constant or by subtracting some constant from all the pixels. Ma'am, how much time do I have?
The session is planned for 1:30. Yeah. We may continue, sir. No issues at all.
Okay, fine. I'll quickly wrap up this. And so, similarly, suppose you have. Yeah, okay, thank you. Suppose you have captured some image into the very sunny environment, so it looks very bright. Okay, so to decrease the brightness, what you need to do is from all the intensity values, you need to subtract some value because all values are very high. When you capture it in very dark, very sunny or bright environment, the intensity values here will be very high. So what you need to do is from each pixel, you need to subtract some constant B, okay, maybe 20, maybe 30, maybe 40, depending upon your requirement. And if you are capturing this image in very dark environment or in low light condition, your image might look like this. So you need to add some value in all intensity so that intensity level of all pixel will go up and it might look like this. Okay. And for bright, you have to subtract so that it can look like this. This is called brightness adjustment. This is contrast adjustment. Okay. This is the original image. This is very high contrast image. This is very low contrast image. So if your image is very dull in the sense it is not having captured all the intensity levels, then it will appear very dull. So in that case, you need to multiply some constant with all the intensity levels. Okay. If that constant is greater than one, then it will increase the contrast of the image. And if it is less than one, then it will decrease the contrast of your image. So what you have to do, suppose C is equal to 0.5 and your intensity value is say, for example, 10 and 200. So this 10 will become 5 and 200 will become 100. After your contrast stretching, because this 0.5 you have to multiply to all the intensity values. Right? So it will become dull. You see that intensity levels are being smaller and smaller. So this is what contrast adjustment. You can have a complement operations like this. So using complement, what you are doing is you are subtracting all the intensity values from 255. So you are simply taking the negation. So pixels having intensity 0 will become 255. Pixels having intensity 255 will become 0. Got it? So your image will look like this ghost kind of image you are generating. This is partial complement. This is partial complement. So intensity between 127 to 255 will remain as it is. And intensity between 0 to 127 will be inverted. That means they will be subtracted from 255. And this is also partial. But what happening here? Exactly inverse. Intensity between 0 to 127 will remain as it is. And rest of will be simply inverted. So you can generate different kind of such kind of ghost images. So you might have seen in movie, okay, like many ghost effects. So you can generate such kind of ghost effect by doing this kind of tricks. Okay, it is not that difficult. Contrast stitching, I am skipping it as of now. Okay, intensity level slicing because we are running out of time. Yeah, histogram equalization, that is fine, yeah. So this is what histogram, you might have seen this. Okay, this is image and this is its histogram. So what is histogram? We have all different intensity 0 to 255 are here. And this is the count of pixels of particular intensity in that image. It means this bar represents how many pixels are there with intensity 50 in this image. This bar will tell you that there are approximately 8,000 pixels are present into the image having intensity something around 155. Got it? So, or you look at this. This is 2x4 image. It is having one pixel with intensity 0. So intensity 0 height, this is intensity 0, intensity 1, intensity 2. There are 3 pixels of intensity 1. So the height of this bar is 3. There is no pixel with intensity 2, so there is no bar. There is only one pixel with intensity 3, so there is only height of this bar is only 1, and so on. So this is how we can construct the histogram. And histogram is very, very important parameter to understand and adjust the quality of the image. Look at this. If your histogram is concentrated towards the beginning of this axis, it says that your image will be very dark because most of the pixels are having dark values. Okay? You see that this represents 255, but you have no pixels having a brighter region. So image is very dark. If your pixels or your histogram is concentrated towards the end of this axis, then definitely your image will be very bright because most of the pixels are having intensity above 127. Nothing is here. Right? If your histogram is concentrated in some particular regions, maybe here or maybe here or anywhere, then you can say that your image is a dull or low contrast image. Okay, because there is no white pixel, there is no black pixel, okay, no dark, no lighter pixels, only some intensity levels are present. So your image looks like a washed out image. And if the histogram of your image is flat, something like this, it means you have a very good quality of image because dark pixels are also present, bright pixels are also present, and pixels with different intensity are also present. It means your image will look good. So if the image is having a very poor histogram, then you can always do some kind of histogram equalization technique. Okay? Or you can apply histogram stitching method so that histogram will be equalized. You see that this is the washed out image. And after histogram stretching, we are getting this kind of effect. So all this you can easily done in Photoshop. And you just move the slider and you will get the different effects. So I would like to summarize the session in a minute. Like we have started with the applications and we have gone through a very big list of applications. And you can opt any of this application as a project for your work. Then we have discussed various type of images like binary image, grayscale image, color image, and indexed image. And we have compared what are the pros and cons of each images. Then we have gone through the formation of the image, like how EM spectrum looks like and what is the visible range, why we are able to see or perceive different colors or different objects. Then we have seen some concepts of sampling and quantization, and we have also seen what will be the effect of sampling and effect of quantization. Right? When you are reducing the sampling, image quality will be poor, and we are reducing the quantization, you will have a less number of grayscale levels or color levels in your image. Then we have seen some image processing applications, like how to image processing algorithms, like how to change the brightness, how to change the contrast. But due to time constraint, I haven't been able to discuss them in detail, and I have skipped many of them. But that session was entirely for to manipulate your image, in short. And finally, we have seen that if histogram is very important tool to visualize your image or to judge the quality of your image. Fine, if it is flattened, then it's good quality image. And if it is not flattened, you can always play with some tools, and you can adjust your histogram to make it a proper quality image. And so thank you all. And if you have any query, we are open for the discussion now. Let me go to the chat box. So if any query is there, I can address them. Yes, still we do not have any query, but if any query, you can paste it here. Yeah, some queries are loaded here. Sir, I mean, how image is processed, taken by like Hubble telescope, and it's same or different that used in nowadays smartphone cameras? See, this is completely different. The smartphone cameras are having very normal lens, you can say. Fine, their focal length is very limited, so they cannot capture the images which are very far. Okay, it hardly captures the images which are in a vicinity of 10 to 100 meters. But to capture the remote objects, you need a lens with specialized focal length. Let me show. Fine, see, all these are lenses. They are having a different capabilities. So this lens, you might have seen such big lenses, fine, or this lens. These are the called telephoto zoom lenses. Such lenses are used to capture the objects which are very far from us. Okay. And the range of this lens depends on what focal length they have. Okay, whether they are a 300 mm focal length or it is having a 600 mm focal length. Fine. So depending upon to the focal length, you will be able to zoom up or zoom in or zoom out. Okay, and you can capture the scene which are very far. So telescopes are having a specialized lens, and they are having a very, very large focal length. And that's why using the telescope, we are able to see in the sky also. Fine. And the, whatever images are taken by them, for that we need a different type of software to process, because they will not be straightforward in JPG format. Whatever images are taken by different satellites, all satellites capture images in different formats. Like in JPG, we have a three layers. Whatever images are taken by the satellites, they are having a different spectrums. Okay, so some images might have a 16 layers, some images might have a 100 layers. So it requires completely different software to process them. And images taken by one telescope or by one satellite cannot be processed by the tool or the software which is written for another satellite, because both might have a different formats. Okay, so ultimately they are capturing images in RAW format. What I mean to say is RAW format means they are just having a number, and we have to process those images using the appropriate tool. Fine. So they are quite different than the smartphone, obviously. Can we store more than 8-bit in color map, and we actually need more than 8-bit, or 8-bit is enough for now? See, in computer, grayscale images are always stored using 8-bit. Okay, so grayscale images are having a 256 different shades, not more than that, not less than that. Fine. And all the color images are represented using 24 bit per pixel. Now this is not in our hand, okay? Because this it depends on the standards, like a JPEG standard, TIFF standard. All the different images are available, like SVG standard. So all these extensions are nothing but a standard, GIF standard. So those standard determines what should be the encoding scheme for the image. Okay, if it is a JPEG, then JPEG has a fixed 24-bit encoding standard. Okay, so you cannot make it 25, you cannot make it 23. Yes, of course, you can compress it, but you cannot change the number of bit per pixel for that. Got it? So you can do that, but for that, you have to write down your own standard. Okay, you have to come up with the separate different extension, I mean to say. Okay. I hope I'm clear to both the questions. Any other questions? Yeah, just a 5 minute. I'll take more 5 minutes to show you that how processing is done. I'm loading very basic Photoshop. Let me take one of the images. See, this is the LANA image. Now see, what I'm doing is I'm going to the adjustment. First, let me color convert it into grayscale. Okay, so but this is the grayscale image I have converted. So what is done? R plus G plus B divided by 3. This is done. Okay, actually it was color. When I have converted into gray, what it is doing in background, algorithm is doing simply R plus G plus B divided by 3. So it is simply taking the average of all three intensity ranges. Now I have different options here. Like see, one is, say for example, brightness and contrast. Okay, I have shown this. So when I'm doing this, now see, you can see some number in this text box. Okay, when I move the slider on right hand side, that number is increasing. So what actually this 100 is? 100 is added into each pixel of this image. Okay. So if original value was 10, after this operation, it has become 110. It means it has become brighter. Got it? So now you can correlate that what software is doing and what exactly happening in behind. Okay, so there is no magic. Now see, this is the original image. Now when I go on this side, image is becoming darker and darker. The reason is that I'm subtracting some value from each of the pixel. Okay, so 100 is subtracted from the intensity of all the pixels. So if intensity was 100, it becomes 0. If it was 200, it becomes 100. So intensity range is coming towards 0, so it becomes darker and darker. Similarly, I can increase the contrast, I can decrease the contrast. Fine. Now you just try to this, you can feel everything whatever we have discussed. Let me show you this curves. See, using this curve also you can play with this. Okay. Actually, this is a 3D. It will be more visible when we have a color image. Let me go to back, Control Z, and then Control M. Now see, it will give me flexibility. See, this is the color image. So I have three plans: red, green, and blue. Suppose I want to reduce the intensity of red color. So what I'm doing is I'm simply stretching this. You see that red is decreasing. And if I want to add green into this, then I will simply lift this up. So green color is added into this. So manipulation is quite simple. It is simply adding some values into the R, G, and B plane. And according to that, image will change. Okay? So all these operations you can try by your own and you will come to know. You can increase the saturation, you can change the hue, all these things. Right? This is completely desaturated image. This is purely saturated images and so on. One last operation, not this one, this one. See, this is the histogram. Before that, let me convert it into black and white so it will be easy for you to understand. So this is the histogram of the image. And you see that there is nothing in beginning as well as nothing at the end. It means this image is missing complete black pixels and complete white pixel, and that's why it appears quite dull, a bit dull, not quite dull. So what I can do is I can simply stretch this. You see that some blackness is added into this image. Can you see that? Okay. Similarly, I'll stretch this end to this. So some brightness is added into this. Got it? So this is how you can adjust the levels and you can have your image of your choice. Now see, this is original image. And this is processed. I'm just changing the preview. Got it? So it's quite easy to play with all this if you know the concepts of image processing. Got it? You can even design your own Photoshop also. You just write down algorithms, design some GUI, and put some sliders. Job is done. Okay, so that's all from my side. We can conclude the session if no one has any query.
Thank you so much, sir. It was really an enriching session. I again would like to thank Dr. Mahesh Goyani, sir, for being dedicated and passionate about delivering a valuable technical session to our students. Thank you so much, sir.
Welcome.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.